Come on, boys. It's time to listen to this week's episode of Snake Bros.
Oh, man, I hope they talk about digging up the Arrowheads.
And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, angels and demons and monsters and serpents and arrowhead diggers and Digger Dan, to episode 57 of Brothers of the Serpent podcast, coming to you not live from the 10 by 10 by 10 tangent cube of science, nestled amongst the dusty bones of an ancient seabed high atop the Edwards Plateau. And we do not have the Watcher with us this week. He
oh,
is
no.
on duty in space. Doing outer something space. In space. Something... secret in space. Okay, but
this episode is about digging holes in the cave with Digger Dan and Dan and Dan.
That's right. We're digging holes with Freely Dan. We had the SnakeBros SnakeForce with us this weekend, digging holes in caves and digging up stuff and finding all kinds of awesome ancient stuff. And it was amazing. And that's what this episode is going to be about. So,
but first... news update.
So regarding last week's news about the sun probe, listener and good friend of the show, Johnny Meany, said that NASA does not need to spend millions of dollars developing a super shield to send a sun probe out to space to test the corona. He said he will throw a giant party at his house and get a keg of the stuff and NASA can come sample it all they want as long as they can pull some hose.
Thanks for that comment. A keg of Corona.
A keg of Corona. NASA, you can come sample it all you want. Thanks to Johnny Meany for that comment. That was badass.
Oh, I do have something to read here.
All right.
It's Snake Bros News.
Snake Bros News.
So I was looking through Ty's iPhone.
Yeah.
We don't have iPhones here on Snake Bros.
No.
Nobody has those on Snake Bros.
Yeah. iPhone, I want you to stop doing that. One button. Go back, iPhone. One button.
But I was looking at his iTunes or iPhone podcast feed, and there was a comment from somebody, Chris Slusher, on his iTunes. It was a comment. We can't see this comment because we don't have
iTunes.
That stuff. So this guy gave us 5 stars, and he said, I just stumbled across this excellent podcast looking for content dealing with the electric universe, and I found it. But that's not all. They dig into all sorts of interesting topics from giants to Tesla to alternative history.
Wow.
These guys are intelligent and open-minded and curious about all the subjects that I am into. I have found my long-lost bros. Snake Bros.
Yes.
So I wanted to give you a shout out, Chris.
Man, that's a great comment. Thank you.
Love the comment. Thanks a lot.
Dang, we need access to iTunes comments, obviously, because yeah. Man, that's a
history.
History.
It's like, dude, he totally gets it.
So that's it for the user comments and, or the listener comments and the news. Now we go to the weather. It's going to be hot.
On the sun.
On the sun. Sun weather will be relatively calm but extremely hot for the next billion years. Now going to meteorology. We're going to have a light meteor shower tonight and possibly moving into large explosions over Siberia in the early morning. And that's
and
it for meteorology.
Seas are 3 feet deep and deeper as you go out.
That's right. Seas are 2 to 3 feet deep and deeper as you go out. I do have this other this space news article that I wanted to read. This is very cool. This kind of goes with space weather, space news. So the headline is, and this is from space.com. If you ever want
really?
Anything about space, you can go to space.com.
Sweet. It's space's website.
That's right. Space has a website. There's spooky plasma music traveling from Saturn to its weirdest moon. This is pretty
Whoa.
Cool. 2 weeks before Cassini, a robot probe, destroyed itself in a controlled dive into Saturn's whirling atmosphere, it heard the gas giant sing to its weirdest moon. When Cassini passed between Saturn and its sixth largest moon, Enceladus, I'm not sure how to say it. It recorded for the first time a vibrating column of plasma passing from the gas giant to the little icy world. Those plasma oscillations looked a lot like the vibrations in the air that we hear as sound, so researchers converted the plasma record into a sound file, making a listenable version of Saturn's song. That recording was published Saturday, July 7th, along with a paper in the Journal of Geophysical Research Letters. Researchers already knew from earlier Cassini observations that Enceladus heavily plucked the magnetic fields around Saturn with its own magnetism and spurting vapors. Enceladus, under its frozen crust, hides a mysterious warm ocean that sometimes vomits up clouds of vapor and organic molecules into the space around Saturn, which, in addition to being a tantalizing hint of conditions that could give rise to life, mess with the electrical energies around the ringed planet. This Cassini observation, conducted during the last stages of the probe's grand finale, is the first recording showing that when Enceladus sends its humming pulses of energy into Saturn's ionosphere, the massive planet sings back. Researchers call that song an auroral hiss, since it's made up of the same stuff, plasma, that people sometimes see as auroras above the Earth. Plasma, a highly electrically conductive state of matter that's similar in some ways to gas, can carry waves inside of it. And it was those waves in the column of plasma reaching from Saturn to Enceladus that you can hear in the video above. If you passed between Saturn and Enceladus, though, you wouldn't hear that high, spooky keening. The waves aren't audible. To hear them, researchers converted their waveforms just straight into sound, in a process similar to how your car radio converts electromagnetic waves into sound, the researchers said in a statement. The researchers then sped the recording up from the 16 minutes of plasma recordings Cassini made on September 2nd, 2017, to a quick audible 28.5 seconds. Mm-hmm. This recording also illustrates a big difference between the distant gas giant and our planet, the researchers wrote. Whereas Saturn interacts energetically with its dynamically close-orbiting moon and even its rings, Earth has no such similar plasma song for its own moon. Our moon is just too stable and too far outside of Earth's ionosphere for the two bodies to get lost in cosmic song. Now I'm going to play part of this for you guys to hear because it's really cool. It's just going to be coming out of my phone speaker, but awesome. it should be all right. So that reminded me. That reminded me a lot of the phasing you were talking about. I was thinking of the, you know, because the probe is moving towards Saturn and away from the moon. It's got that.
Yeah.
Right.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Man, that's really awesome.
So you guys can go to space.com and check that out, and you can play the video, and it shows you the waveform as the sound. You know, it shows you the waveform and the line as the sound moves through, or the video moves through the sound, and you can see what's happening. It's pretty cool. Wow. So
that's awesome, man.
Space weather. Space weather done. Saturn probe.
Yeah. Plasma as a medium for the transmission of waves.
That's right.
It's awesome. Loving it.
Yep. So now to the main topic for this show, our trip.
Oh, man, that was an awesome trip. As you all know, we went to parts unknown in Texas on the Devil's River and participated in an archaeological dig.
Yep.
In some caves there.
And shelters, really.
Shelters and one of them was definitely a cave.
Yeah.
But they call them shelters, and you can call it what you want. But it was freaking mind-blowing. That's all I have to say. The actual work that we took part in was rigorous and extremely dirty. The dust was everywhere and very thick, and we were all... in a short amount of time, completely covered from head to toe with...
And that's why we had to wear these arrowhead hunting digging masks.
That's right.
Because it was incredibly dusty.
But it was so badass, dude. Russ and I teamed up. We had a sifter and a digger. Russ did most of the bucket filling and dug a tunnel way back in.
You were like a worm.
Yeah. The wormhole. It was awesome. We found... two really good Val Verde arrowheads or points, projectile points. And from what I've been told, they're dated at around 5,000 to 6,000 years old. I actually looked that up and I couldn't find the dating there was a website, the only one that I could find that had information. And for some reason under the dating column, it wouldn't load the text.
No.
I don't know.
Yeah, they were saying middle to late archaic, which is usually like 5 to 8
or something, right?
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's right. Because early, like middle archaic starts at 8.
Okay.
So like early archaic is 10, 12 to 10.
Yeah.
Yeah. So middle to late archaic is like basically from 8 to 5,000 years, roughly.
We found some other bases, broken.
Meaning the bottoms. The top,
but I don't know what those were called. I can't remember. Our guide knew the names of all of them, which was cool. We also found bone fragments, some polished bone, an antler that was probably used as an awl, like a something to poke holes or whatever.
That's like a needle.
Yeah.
Or possibly a shank. I was looking at
it
and thinking.
Yeah, it might be. We don't really know, but it had some definite, you know, work or usage marks and scrapes on it.
Yeah.
Some of the other guys, Brenner found a freaking awesome bone awl that is, I mean, it was polished and sharpened to a point.
Yeah. Incredibly rare find.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Yeah.
And
most bone awls are not complete and intact.
Yeah. Wesley found a freaking perfect, what's called a Kerrville knife. It has a large fat base that you can hold in the palm of your hand.
It's made out of flint. Yeah,
and
like an arrowhead.
Yeah. And the knife comes out and is rounded. It's called a duckbill Kerrville knife. It's rounded at the end like a duckbill. But it was super thin, about 2.5 inches wide, 4 to 5 inches long. Just and then finely worked all the way around the blade edge. It was just beautiful. So we found a lot of good stuff.
Yeah, he kept calling it his KK. Just wait till I put my KK in my cave case.
It's his Kerrville knife. My KK. We had so much fun swimming in the river and getting drunk.
I tried to get lost and die and failed. I completely failed. So I want to set the scene real quick for people who like don't know where we went, because none of you do, except for the SnakeBros SnakeForce. Thank you guys. Also, by the way, it was a badass weekend. The whole time was awesome.
Yeah.
SnakeBros SnakeForce. Woo!
One of my favorite, favorite trips I've ever taken.
Yeah.
I mean, it was just, what did you say we had? Russ is like, I had a mystery boner the whole time.
That's right. I had a gigantic mystery boner the entire time I was there.
It was, yeah. Our minds were blown to tiny bits the entire time.
That's right.
Real quick, before you describe the scenery, one of the shelters that I am still flipping out about has what we were calling scree or tailings. They look like mine tailings coming off the side of the hill. And nothing but grass and a few small shrubs would grow there. And on either side of the tailings, there was trees and, you know, just the normal brush of the landscape. But it was obviously different what would grow in the tailings. And they were just full of what we call burn rock, flint chips worked. I mean, I'm sure there's probably tons of artifacts in there.
Yeah.
There was, it's ash and, you know, dirt and everything, rubble just coming off the side of this shelter. And it was so enormous, the size of the tailings, it just was mind-boggling how
it looked like the kind of tailings scree, like the tailings that you would see from a modern mine. Like you just, you know, like there's this cliffside, and then there's just this humongous like rock slide of gravel. It's basically gravel because they're all the rocks are basically the same size. They're roughly hand, like palm shaped,
fist
sized, and they're squarish. Like they've been broken by regular action or whatever. And it just is pouring down the side of the hill. And you could definitely see the difference between that and the regular hillside stuff that had been falling off the side of the hill for because of nature.
And you climb up it. And when you get into the shelter, which is basically like a massive overhang of rock, and the cliff wall is probably 60 feet, maybe 100 feet up.
Yeah, it's way up there.
And then, I mean, the hill continues to go up above that, but it's just...
The hill itself was a peninsula
that
stuck out, and it was like, so it's like a finger of rock. Like the hill sort of narrows and narrows until it's basically like this finger of rock that's straight up and down cliffs. And just at the very bottom of the cliffs, like on the bottom, say maybe 1/5 of it, is a little scree ramp from natural stuff falling down. But then there's this, tailings
that
slide
bulges out of that.
And the cliff itself is like a sheer face. It's basically a sheer face, but then part of it has been dug into. You can tell the difference because the natural rock itself, the old rock, has got this blue patina, a mold and sun damage patina on it. But where the rock has been chipped out and then it's then protected from the sun, it's sort of yellow because that's the natural color of limestone. And
there were red ochre markings on the walls inside. And from end to end, it was at least 200 feet,
yeah.
I think. I didn't actually measure it, but we have to measure stuff on the ground all the time at our work. And it just, I would say it was all of 200 feet.
Yeah.
Easy.
Yep.
And if you were standing next to the wall inside the shelter, the elevation of the top of the mounded up material that's sliding down the hill is far above your head.
Yeah.
I mean, it was just, and so it, like, we're trying to figure out how people could have lived in these conditions. Like, they're called shelters, and it makes sense that you would go there for shelter, but it also doesn't because it's full of ash. And any commotion going on inside, I guess if you weren't digging in there, it wouldn't really be a problem.
But even just walking around that first night when we got there,
yeah,
the dust particles started to, just because we were walking around on it.
Yeah. And so if you had 20 people in there walking around, it's going to be, and if you were doing that every day, people are going to be dying. There's just no way you can breathe that fine material into your lungs every single day and survive for any length of time. So it doesn't, that part of it didn't make sense. It's like, how did they work here? I don't know. So we all weekend, we were all kicking around theories, and it was a lot of fun.
I do think that particular one was a mine, I don't think people lived there because of the sun in the afternoon, because it was west facing.
Yeah, they could have been a winter shelter as well.
Yeah, it could have been a winter shelter, or it may be that deep down underneath that piled up,
It's a cave,
that it goes
that's
far.
That's what I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's a cave for sure. Because the one that we dug in was a cave. I mean, where people had excavated down,
it went way back in there. Yeah.
But I assume
that one was north facing or something.
If we had seen that one before anybody had excavated, I bet it would look very similar. It's just like sort of an overhang and a big pile of stuff sliding down the hill.
Yeah. So the country that we were in was very rugged, like incredibly rugged. It was all limestone canyons, very steep. There were high cliffs. Enormous boulders had tumbled down from the cliffs from natural erosion. And I mean enormous, like house-sized boulders rolled down the cliffs. And they're sometimes very precariously balanced on other very small boulders. Where you're like, I could live under here if I didn't care about being smashed if there was a thunderstorm. There are, like, the first night we got there, of course, we were like, let's go exploring right now. It's pitch black, right? So we throw on our headlamps and we go try to get lost and die. And the next day, the guy who manages the place was like, did you guys go down to that place, that canyon? And we're like, yeah. And he was like, oh, because, like, we have, like, 8 mountain lion traps down there. So, they're always trying to – there's very large animals that can kill you. And very small ones that can also kill you, like snakes. But we get along with snakes here at Snake Bros.
Yeah.
So we met a rattlesnake and he was cool with us.
Yeah, we met a rattlesnake that night while we were climbing around, and he came right at me because he was like, Snake Bros!
Snake Bros!
And I was like, no, bro, don't get too close. Don't get inside my snake bubble.
Stay out of my snake bubble, snake.
So, yeah. I tossed a little rock at him and he turned left.
Yeah. Yeah. But what was interesting to me, the first thing I noticed about the surrounding countryside is, like, again, I was saying, like, it's all these limestone cliff faces, and it looks like it used to be full of water. Way up high, like, say, I don't know, what would you say, maybe 20, 30 feet below the very tops of the cliffs, there was this deep, rounded incut, like a half pipe.
Yeah, it's hard to say, but yeah, it's
maybe and it was in different places. It was at different heights because of the different heights of the hills. But it looked to me like that cut, you could kind of follow it all the way around the hills and see that it was at roughly the same level. Like the whole place used to be full of water, and there were these little islands, or it was like an archipelago or something like that.
Yeah. The surrounding landscape, like beyond the river, if you go any distance beyond the river, it's all pretty much high plains.
Yeah.
You know, there's rolling hills.
Yeah.
But once you get near the river, it drops off 600 feet in elevation very quickly.
Right. Which we measured that with GPS. Yeah.
Right. And it's just basically it's everywhere the river is and all of its tributaries is a massive just canyons.
Yeah.
And so that's where we were looking, like we're looking at the canyon walls and you can see these consistent, seemingly at the same elevation, little rounded, you know, overhangs cut in the sides of the solid rock.
Right. And it's the I can't remember what they're called geologically, but it's the kind of erosion that's made by constant wave action, basically. It isn't lateral and it isn't vertical. It is a sort of a... It's made by waves impacting the wall, like small waves basically impacting the walls, and it cuts it out into this rounded shape that cuts into the hills. And it's a very common geological feature. Like anywhere where there's a water line that was there for a long time, there's this rounded feature that's cut into the walls from the mainly
water that has a fairly consistent
depth
wave action.
Yes.
Like you would think of inland sea or small, you know, large lakes.
Yeah, exactly.
That have pretty consistent wave action. Like
right.
The ocean or a large gulf will have massive waves every now and again. And then, you know, the wave action fluctuates so much.
Yes.
That they will not often cut very consistent looking.
Right.
Formations exactly. Like this.
Yeah. And it was deep enough to imply that the water had been stable there for a while. I'm no geologist, so I can't say how long. And also that would require knowing the sort of the hardness of the limestone there. But it was up near the caps of the hills, so it's probably pretty hard limestone.
Yeah.
It's dug into the part of the limestone that protected the hill from being eroded in the first place. So that was interesting because that cut was almost at the level of the shelter that we were digging in initially. That cut was kind of just below it. I remember now because you and I went walking around the side of the hill and we kind of went down a bit and then it was right there.
Yeah.
So it was at the level of or just below the level of the shelters that we were working in. So the water level at one point was very close to the shelters themselves, which may explain more of why people live there because the water could have been just a little bit ways down from the shelter.
Yeah.
But we've been trying to figure this out since we got there because it's very difficult to understand the situation these people were in. Like they definitely, it seems ridiculous that they were living in the shelters we were looking at when the water from the river was so far away and so difficult to get to.
Yeah. The other theory that we kind of came up with, we started calling them shaman caves.
Yeah.
Right?
That's right.
Because it,
this is shaman school.
If you go down the hill, you know, 300 or 400 feet in elevation to the bottom and you get close to the river, there are massive areas of what they call camp. And it's basically this very similar materials and similarly aged or dated points, you know, projectile points.
Yeah.
Are found in these, what they call midden or, you know, Indian mounds. And the camps are just vast. They go all along the riverside. And then, you know, so you're finding artifacts that are the same in terms of style as the ones up in these caves that are way far away from water and way up high on the cliff edge. And so that was one of the problems with the idea that there would be water, you know, filling the area, because how are you having the same types of artifacts found in the two same places, which are what if there was water there, one of them is 300 feet underwater.
Yeah.
So we started calling them shaman caves because it's kind of typical that the shaman would live away from the tribe and he would have a special kind of weird, you know, sort of like a monk lives up in some crazy situation away from the rest of the civilization.
That's right, yeah.
And they learn all things. Like, they learn all these different things, or they develop different things. Like, you know, they make baskets, they make sandals. They, you know, they're like scientists. They're that's what kind of we were looking at it. Like, they're making these bone awls for weaving baskets and doing, you know, whatever, all this other types of intricate work. And then down by the river, you don't find any of that stuff. Now, those are perishables. So that may be why you don't find them.
They were very well preserved in all that ash.
Right. They're in the caves. They were protected.
It seems like, especially because we were looking at the
shaman school. That was what it was.
Shaman school.
The caves were shaman school. So, like, the tribe would send, you know, one or two of their young guys. Like, okay, you're a nerd. You're going to shaman school.
Going to shaman school. Oh man.
No, the nerds would love it, right? They were like, screw you guys.
That's right. Yeah, they'd be being made fun of by all the braves until they get sent to shaman school, and then the braves are afraid of them after that.
But anyway, I'm sorry. What were you saying?
But yeah, so we were finding they had these they would do this thing with the cactus that's kind of cactus there that would make it into this beautiful paintbrush. So we were finding those and we think they're paintbrushes. That's what they look like. And
Brenner actually found one that looks like it had some type of substance like stuck to the end of the brushes. Like, you know, it could have been, it doesn't have to be paint. It could have been any type of.
Yeah. Any kind of any
mixed
kind of
material that they were spreading on something.
Right.
Or substance, whatever it is.
Yeah. Pitch for your baskets.
Pitch. Exactly.
Had to get that bitumen. So, again, like, I think that a large part of the activity, because the rubble was so regular, at least in the mine area, they were, you know, what people call burn rock. They're very, like we were saying, fist size, squarish, regular. They were breaking them up to get the flint out. The first one we were talking about that's on the cliff face where the scree is coming down and it looks like mine tailings, there were huge flint nodules in that cliff.
Yeah, deposits of flint in the side of the cliff.
Like, you could look up and see these enormous deposits of flint that were hanging above your head that they were obviously breaking apart. Probably using fire or something. I don't know, shamirs, whatever.
Yeah, and the first shelter we were in had black, soot all over the ceilings and parts of it where they were obviously burning.
Yes,
you know.
Yeah, and that will. You were talking about, like, why are we finding these weird flat sections of limestone that were breaking off the ceiling, and it was probably because of the fires, right?
Right.
Because you burn your fire and the pieces of the ceiling are going to fall off because limestone gets real brittle.
It flakes. Yeah. There were just, I mean, billions of tiny little dime-sized thin flakes of limestone. And they were, you know, you could look at some of the walls of material that where somebody had dug down and exposed, you know, a sheer wall of the occupation layers. And you're looking down through it and you can see all these little flakes of that limestone sticking out of it. And they're not stratified. They're not all sitting flat. They're vertical. They're every angle. And then in there is just every type of everything that's in it, in different orientations. It was not laid down. Cause at first we started talking about the caves were flooded.
Yeah.
You know, they're flooded. And this was an inundation. But we proved ourselves wrong on that theory because there was no stratification of the layers.
So it seems like it, like the hypogeum. It was a non-stratified, like, complete layer. All that stuff was laid down at the same time. Like, it had to have been, you know.
Or just in a similar way. And so if you imagine that they were burning, you know, they're burning fires and they're getting flakes falling from the ceiling. And then they also get hit with a big rainstorm, you would get a lot of the stuff that's mounded up on the outside to wash in. But then it gets excavated by the people living there again, and that goes piled up on the outside again, and then they burn some more and more flakes fall, and a big storm.
That's what I mean. Like, eventually, at some point, everything washes in there and then it stays. And that's
right.
That's what we're
digging in.
Right. Yeah. So, yeah, it could happen to them multiple times, and they would dig it all back out so that they could live in it.
And it would be stirring it all up and mixing it together.
Right. But then eventually something happens where they don't come back, and there's a big storm or there's a flood or something like that, pushes it all back in there as one layer.
Yeah.
That we find now. And we're like, why is everything mixed up? Like, I did notice that the bone awls tended to be closer to the top than the bottom, which was interesting because I'm like, that stuff will float. You know,
people
that were digging down deeper were finding more of the, like, some of the better arrowhead points.
The stone artifacts. Yeah.
Yeah, the stone artifacts were down deeper, whereas, like, up near the top, we were finding the paintbrushes and the bone awls and the mm-hmm. various, but, like,
the lighter materials.
Yeah.
And so I could, you know, you could imagine that, say, 4 or 5 feet would be like that.
Yes.
And then if you went an additional 4 or 5 feet down, you might run into another layer of light material.
That's right.
Because
from a previous
inundation or whatever.
Because we don't know how deep the shelter is, folks.
And in one of them, we were told that an institution had come and did two excavations, each one 25 feet deep, and they did not hit the bottom of the occupation layers.
Right.
But they had found every, you know, artifacts from every period all the way back to paleo.
Yeah.
12,000
years. Folsom and Clovis.
Yeah.
Which means if they can, and that's why they stopped, because they knew that if they kept
digging they knew
farther,
that they were done.
Right. If they kept digging farther, they would start finding pre-Clovis stuff, and they don't want to do that. Whoever lived there before were not Indians, not people. It was animals setting fires and making arrowheads. And
yeah. But it was, overall, it was just mind-boggling, and we've been kicking around all these theories and ideas, but
right, because
it's a huge freaking mystery.
Just the shelters themselves and the depositions in them was difficult to understand. But then when you look at the greater context of the area that they're in and the water levels that were obvious, and then like, okay, so how did this stuff had to be deposited here? And of course, that's supposed to be incredibly ancient. It's supposed to be a late Cambrian, an inland sea that deposited all these limestone layers, and then that dries up or over long periods of time, according to uniformitarianism, that dries up over long periods of time, dries out, and it's gone. And then like freshwater or rainwater erosion periodically, plus the monsoon period, we're supposed to have a monsoon period, mm-hmm. comes in and cuts all the canyons through the layers of stuff that the, you know, floods that river and all the canyons and everything, and erodes it all down. Right. And then at some point those people come in and live. But then you see that there's this freshwater line that has to be post-ocean. Right.
Yep. According to if you're following the standard model, it none of it lines up, because the cave has to be post when the river was even up higher,
right,
much higher at elevation, because that was supposed to happen way, way long ago.
Exactly. Yeah.
Over millions of years, and
none of it lined up or made sense. And that's so, like, looking in the greater context, we didn't understand what was happening. And then just looking at the shelters by themselves, we didn't understand. It was like a fractal mystery. That's why I had a giant mystery boner the whole weekend. Like, no matter how much you zoomed out or zoomed in, the mystery was the same amount of mystery. And it was just crazy.
Yeah.
If we didn't understand what was going on, no matter what scale we looked at it at.
Yep. It was awesome.
It was so badass.
And then SnakeForce.
It was also great to like wake up early in the morning, like freaking scarf down some pancakes, run down to the show. Like, we had to walk basically about 200 yards or whatever. Like, basically you're like running along a fence line, and then you climb over the fence, and then you get down under the cliff, you go to the shelter, you put on your mask and your goggles, you get completely freaking filthy of like with ash dust and like bone dust and all that shit. And then we get out, all of us are like gray. We all look the same. We're trailing dust as we walk up the hill, and then we go down to the river, jump into the water, and make like gray streams of water going down the river. And then we get clean and we drink hundreds of beers, and then we get back out, we take a nap, we eat some more pancakes, and then we go back down there and dig some more. It was badass.
Yeah. It was.
Oh, man. It was one of the best trips I've ever been on, for sure. That was what it was, right up there. But there's even more to talk about, and we're going to take a quick break. And we'll come back and talk about the other massive mystery that we found in this place.
Do you want to go straight to pyramids? Join Snake Bros Snake Force, an elite group of snakes that get lost and die.
Oi, I joined Snake Bros Snake Force, and we drank hundreds of beers in a river named after the devil.
Have you given all your money to the Snake Bros Pyramid Scheme? Make it all back now by joining Snake Force.
I joined Snake Bros Snake Force and found thousands of dollars in ancient cave artifacts.
Snake Bros Snake Force, join now.
Snake Force is not actually responsible for anybody getting lost and dying.
Oh,
the sands of time and the ethereal mists of the universe to the tangent cube of science. We are back. Snake Bros, Snake Force.
Snake Force!
How about that commercial we just busted out in the break?
Join now.
Join now. Snake Bros, Snake Force.
We are not responsible for the millions of beers that you drank.
First, you have to donate all your money to the pyramid scheme.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, so... At the end of the last break, I kind of teased a little bit about the other massive mystery we found here. So Kyle and I and Ty, actually, the first night we got there, we drove down after work on Friday afternoon. So we got there. It was after dark. We pulled up and we were like, let's go exploring. So we went and we went down into the valley. And I guess you kind of knew a rough area of where a shelter was, right?
That's what. Yeah. We had a... We had some drop pins.
That's right. That's right.
And I was looking at a satellite image of the roads, and so I knew where to go to get to it. So we drove down to the river, and I knew that it's actually right where a tributary meets the river, and so I knew that we could hike up that canyon, that dry creek bed, and get to that shelter. So that was the goal.
Right. So we went hiking up that canyon, and in the middle of the night, it was tough. It was difficult, even with headlamps and everything, too, because the brush, I mean, like, you know, you look at it on satellite pictures, and it just looks like desert scrub, but it's all taller than your head. So it was difficult to, and the canyon bottom was lots of, like, piles and piles of river rock gravel and large boulders with you know, desert sage and juniper bushes growing out of it. And so it was difficult in the dark to the idea was to stay in the middle of the canyon and stay in the waterway. But the waterway is overgrown because it hasn't had water in it for who knows how long, or at least not enough water to wash all that stuff out of there. So we were getting stuck by thorny things and getting scraped and scratched, and we were looking for serpents and
everything is trying to kill you out there.
That's right. Out there, everything is trying to kill you or stab you or inject seeds and poison into you. So we finally come up out of this wash of the canyon where all this river rock, all these like round, like ball bearing rock gravel is. And we come up onto this flat, like it's flat rock limestone where it's basically been washed down to this very hard layer. And as soon as we started to walk up on this flat, Kyle and I were both like, these are footprints.
Yeah.
The whole flat was covered. And so in the dark, it was difficult to get the scope of this. We didn't realize until a little bit later that there was this enormous cliff wall next to us. Kyle like focused his light and saw it way out there in the distance in the dark, like looming way up over us. We were like, holy crap. But I was flipping out. We were both flipping out about these footprints. They were the floor of the canyon was just pockmarked with footprints that we were recognizing as prints. You could see definite toe marks on large animal prints.
Yeah.
And that was what we were first recognizing. And then we started to see like these look like human.
Yeah. Multiple toed.
Right. Like first we're seeing multiple toed, but some of them are very large. You know, and like, we're like, that looks like a human footprint, but that's pretty freaking big, or that's really wide. Right. But you could see all the toes, the prints of what you would expect to be smaller animals like humans, because relative to what we were seeing down there, the humans were the smallest animals in there.
Yeah.
They were like not as deeply impacted. And then the bigger prints were much deeper, and it was like all very regular. You could see where the mud had been squeezed between the toes on the prints. I mean, they were incredibly clear. And there were hundreds of them that were not nearly as clear, but they were still there. And that was really blowing my mind. And so I was and that was in the dark. Then we climbed up to the shelter and we were looking at that, and that was also blowing our mind. So the next day we went digging and we dug all day and everything. And,
Brenner and I actually during the lunch break, which we took, which was like 2 hours long and included hundreds of beers in the river. Brenner and I hiked up that canyon again because I was like, dude, you got to see these. I had been talking about them all night and all day. And I was like, dude, you want to go up there and see these? And he's like, yeah. So we hiked up there in our swim trunks and flip flops. But in the day, it was a lot easier to not get stabbed and injected with stuff. So we got up there in the daytime, and that was the first time I'd seen him in the daytime, and it blew my mind even more. Like, when we first stepped onto the flats, and I'll put these pictures in the show notes. When we first stepped onto the flats, you could see amongst the hundreds of footprints, there is a very large set of some quadruped that was just like, you could see where he was walking. You could see his path. It was very clear.
Yeah.
And Brenner stood there just like, oh my God. Like, I'm like, dude, these are fucking footprints, bro. And we walked all up and down looking at him and everything. And it was crazy. So, the next day, I didn't have a camera with me that time. So I knew that I needed to go back a third time to go to document it. So after we dug all that day, that was the digging day. The next day we had decided, like, we were pretty worn out, especially Kyle and I. We have like old injuries in our backs. So we decided that maybe we wouldn't focus so much on digging in the shelter that we had been digging before. And we would go check out this other shelter that was in this canyon. And I wanted to look at the footprints again, and I was going to take my camera. So I did. I took my phone, basically. That was all I had for a camera. And I took a bunch of photographs, and I was throwing my Bic lighter down as a relative size. Like, I didn't have the proper tools. Like, you know, you need a measuring. Like, geologists do it. They have these little sticks that show you. It's black and white, and it shows you, like,
yeah,
measurements.
Inches. Yeah.
Yeah, and I needed, you know, the depth of the prints. I didn't get to do any of that. I basically was tossing my lighter down either in the print if it was big enough, or setting it next to it if it was smaller, and I didn't want to like obscure any of it, and took photos. And in some of the photos, my shadow was obscuring the print because I wasn't paying attention to that as much. And it was incredibly hot. And then I decided to go get lost and die. We had been told about another shelter up that canyon. Basically, the guy was like, okay, so you go up that canyon where that big wash is, and then you kind of go off to the right, and way up there is another shelter, and he was telling us about it. So I decided, like, these guys, Kyle went up, and they found the KK up in the other shelter, and they were stuck, they were digging there. So I was
I was up in there crawling around on my hands and knees because I didn't want to dig.
Yeah.
There's so much stuff that I was like, all right. And I put my respirator on and just like got on my hands and knees and crawled. Yeah. Crawled all over the floor back and forth and just kind of scraped with my hands a little bit and found a bunch of artifacts. Nothing whole, but it was awesome.
Yeah. Meanwhile, I completely violated all like rules of propriety and like consideration by forgetting my radio and going anyway up the canyon and not telling anybody where I was going exactly and just heading off into the darkness into the canyon. So I went up there. I got part of the way up the canyon and I was like, crap, I forgot the radio. Oh man. You know, and I didn't have any smokes. Like I realized like, I don't have any cigarettes. And I don't have a radio, but I'm going to do this anyway. Snake Bros, Snake Force, go. So like, so I hiked all the way up, and I'm hiking up this, and you know, the idea was that we were going to get guided to this shelter, but I figured that wasn't going to happen that day because things turned out to where it wasn't going to happen. And so I was like, I want to go try to find this thing. And I didn't know exactly where it was or what it even looked like or what to even look for. So as I was going, I was being very careful because like whenever I came to a place where there was water, because there were some spots where the rock had been eroded away deep and there was a pool of like stagnant water sitting in there. And those are trap points for large predators. So I would be very careful and, you know, like, kitties, I'm coming through, kitties, please don't scratch me. I kept climbing up the hills to kind of get a view ahead of me because the canyon is, again, full of rubble and large boulders that have rolled down into it. And at one point I climbed up the side, maybe, I don't know, 50 feet, and looked out and I saw a shelter way out there, which the next day Kyle and I went and looked at it. You saw it from afar.
Yeah.
So that was basically the point at which I climbed up and I saw it way out there. And I was like, oh my God.
Yeah.
That's it. That's it. The one he was telling about.
And
so I was
it
like,
looks freaking awesome.
Yeah.
Too.
So I was like, I got to get to it. So It looked far away, but I spent 2 years hiking through country like this at a job that we were working where we were out in the middle of nowhere with no service or anything like that. But I did have radios, and this time I didn't have a radio. But anyway, I hiked up the canyon. It was very curvy, and then I kept losing sight of the shelter I was trying to get to because the canyon would curve and I would lose sight of it, and then it would curve again and I could see it and it was closer and I would curve again. And I was taking videos during this and photographs and trying to kind of document what I was doing and also getting partial sunstroke and being goofy and stupid. Then I got to the base of the hill where the shelter was and I realized exactly how high up there it was, and I was like, oh my God, this is going to be a serious climb. So I started hoofing it up the cliff, at the bottom of it. Imagine a lake that has completely drained of water, right? So if you're standing on the shoreline of the lake and right at the shoreline, it just drops off a good 50 feet. And then beneath that, at the bottom of that, it just sort of ramps down very steeply because there's limestone shelves, and each one has a ramp of scree or, rubble going up into it. So I could usually scramble up the shelf and then climb the ramp to the next shelf and then scramble up the next shelf. But when I got to the top part, which is the shelves were getting too high. So I actually had to throw my canteen up the shelf and then finger and toe rock climb up the thing and then get to that level. And I had to do that twice. And I got up there and then I got into the shelter and it was amazing. I didn't find any artifacts, any arrowheads or anything like that. But it was like being inside of a giant coral brain. That's what it looked like. It was – the ceiling was – looked like neurons. It was just all this crazy – and then so the ceiling was full of these holes that are – think of a giant piece of coral. All these holes. And, of course, I'm careful because – those holes can have anything in them.
Yeah. And in one of the shelters we went to, there was a beehive in there, and you just never know if they're Africanized or not. And
yeah. And we had actually been told that there was a shelter nearby this area where there was a beehive in it. Fortunately, this had nothing in it. Now, I did see very large cat prints with kitty hair. I was like, I recognize that kitty hair. I have a cat. Please don't kill me, kitties. And he had kind of been sleeping up in the the right corner of it. So the shelter itself was shaped like the inside of a fishbowl. Think of that, think of a fishbowl with the top covered in coral, and then a hole broken in the side of the bowl. That was where the hole was to get in and out of the shelter. That's what it was like. But it looked like coral from the inside. It was all these crazy worm things that were maybe the size of my wrist, crawling all over the wall, but they were hard as rock. But they surrounded these holes, these pockets up into it, like coral would have. And I was looking in the pockets to make sure that they weren't filled with bats or snakes or any other large desert insects trying to kill me. I realized that I saw this white dust on the edge of one. So I kind of poked at it with a rock and nothing came out of it. So I reached my hand up in there and pulled out beach sand. And I mean, it was straight up. It was, and inside the cave, despite the fact that it was probably 100 degrees outside, in that fishbowl of coral, it was incredibly cool and quiet and calming, and the wind was blowing, and so it would come in there, and it was just, I don't know, it was an amazing place. Yeah, it was almost spiritual, it was like a cathedral. It didn't have the echoey effect. It was very, because all those holes and everything created some kind of dampening where it was, it didn't, echo when I talked or whatever.
Yeah.
But I reached in there and pulled out this beach sand, and I was like, oh, and it felt exactly like sand on the beach that had just been sun-dried after having the ocean wash over it. It was cool and sort of damp and just had that beach sand feel that I can't describe, it when you got it in your hand, you're like, this is sand from the beach. Right. Yeah. And I smelled it and it smelled like ocean.
That's cool.
And I was like, if it smells like ocean, does it taste like ocean? And yep, it tasted like salt.
Wow.
Up in the holes, I could see them. And I got some pictures and video of this, were these enormous spiral shell fossils. And I found one on the floor of the cave so people were asking me well, do you think it could have been brought up there? No, yes, I guess. But there were huge ones just like it stuck in the ceiling that I couldn't get. And I wouldn't have damaged the cave anyway trying to get them if I had a rock hammer. But You could see them, and I got a picture of one up in the hole. You could see this massive spiral coming out, and I identified it. I'm pretty sure it's a form of gastropod called an orthonema, but it's a Paleozoic, very ancient, giant gastropod shell. Now, this is just me doing research. I'm not a paleontologist, and I'm not a marine paleontologist. I don't know this for sure, but this is my guess based on the fossil that I found and what it looked like. And then the research that I did on the internet, it looks like a type of gastropod shell, but it's a giant one. They don't grow this big now. So it's very old, and I was getting confusing and conflicting eras and dates for them, but it was like basically late Jurassic was what it was coming down to. This was 400 feet above the flat plain where we were finding human footprints, guys.
Yeah, that's
a late Jurassic marine shell in sediment 400 feet above other also marine sediment that was mud at the time that humans were making footprints in it.
And dinosaurs.
And large, what are known as Pleistocene or Pliocene megafauna.
Were they humans or
hominids?
Hominids.
But there were definitely Homo sapiens. The two best footprints I got, the ones that I showed the guy, and I showed it to him, and I was like, dude, this is. Remember,
yeah,
I
those showed, look those
are like, Homo sapiens. I mean, I'm almost sure. But and I'll put these in the show notes. I've got all these pictures, and I've got all this ready to throw in the show notes. Like, there is a very clear print of a Neanderthal, at least one, and there I think that I've got two or three, and it's incredibly clear. Like, I've got this, I went and downloaded this thing that shows footprint silhouettes of all these different types of apes and hominids and stuff. And the Neanderthal one is in the top center, and they've got this wide foot with almost a flat arch, and then their toes are very spread out, and their big toe is very large and prominent, right?
Yeah.
And there's that exact print in one of my photographs. And I've got the lighter in it, and the it's a standard Bic lighter, so everybody knows how big those are, you know. And it's dwarfed by the print itself. It was this a huge foot, but it's the Neanderthal profile. Neanderthals are supposed to be from say 125, maybe 200,000 years ago to 50,000 years ago. They died out. At least 50,000 years ago is the latest they were supposedly around. Okay. But there are other prints in that same strata on that same canyon floor that are clearly what is also identified in these pictures I have. There's another photo I've got or an image that I have that's basically like what looks like a topography profile of prints of these very ancient hominids. There's one of Australopithecus afarensis or something like that. It's the 3.7 million year old hominid. Then there's Homo erectus. Which is labeled as being 1.5 million years old. Okay, 1.5 million years old. I have and that print profile looks very similar to what we would have a print today, but the only toe that shows is the big toe, and it's way out there, right? So you see like the human foot. Imagine the human footprint without the toes on it, and then just take the big toe print, make it much larger, and put it way out above the rest of the foot, and none of the other toes are there. That's a classic Homo erectus. 1.5 million year old hominid print, and those are also in the same strata with Neanderthal man, with Homo sapiens, with giant dinosaurs and megafauna. It's just like basically, yeah, we're looking at it and we're like,
hold up, wait a minute, something ain't right.
Yeah,
it was just like that.
And once again, if you follow the standard model of everything, none of the stuff that we were doing or seeing makes any sense. Finding, right. Whatever, it just...
Massive mystery boners. So I documented these footprints, and the more I've been looking at them, the more I think that they're... Okay, so we've talked about the Paluxy River footprints on here before. Now, what's interesting about the Paluxy River, it's in the Glen Rose Formation, which is also in Texas. We have Glen Rose Formation here where we live. This stuff was not Glen Rose, I don't think. I'm not sure about that. But the point is that Paluxy...
It might have been because And the reason why I say that is because of the massive flint nodules
you could be
contained
right.
inside. Like, that only happens at a certain elevation. Below that, you it's won't not find there. Those. Yeah.
Right, because it's lightning bolt ejecta or something.
Yeah. But I mean, that's just been what's been documented, is that they, like, you get up to a certain elevation.
Or down to a certain elevation, and they're
yeah,
not there.
And you start finding, yeah, once you get down so far, you won't find them anymore.
Right. Or up so far or whatever, yeah. Do they go all the way to the top, or are they,
I don't
just,
know.
Okay.
Yeah, that I don't know. I just know that, like, a lot of the places, you know, because I've been interested in you know, artifact hunting, a lot of these high hilltops that actually reach to the Glen Rose level will be where, you know, ancient sort of occupation sites are, lookouts.
I see.
Where they were mining that material and bringing it down to the riverbed.
I see.
Where they were making artifacts.
Okay.
So they're getting the flint from up there. And then I've been on places where, like, one of the places that I found three, I mean, just like side by side, definite mounds. I mean, they're mounded up in a triangle right next to the river in like a flat valley. The river's making a bend, and it's literally, you know, cut the whole side of a hill off.
Yeah.
And it's just a sheer wall, and it's just all this white.
Yeah.
Sedimentary layers that are full of the bivalve fossils and the spiral shell valve. I don't know what those are called. All of these fossils, no flint whatsoever, and it's all a particular color. And then right at the very top, it turns red. And when you go up there, if you hike up on that hilltop, it's just – when you're hiking up, everything's white, and you might find a few kind of flint nodule or pieces of some worked flint that are down on the side. But once you get up to the – it turns red and is just loaded, like full of natural flint deposits and everything. It just appears on that layer. And I went out there with an actual geologist. We had contacted the
– An actual geologist, folks.
We'd contacted the with the landowner, the archaeological society, and they arranged a meeting, and we went out there together with some professionals and some members of the archaeological society, and I hiked all over the ranch with them and showed them everything that I had found at the different places, and that hilltop was one we went to, and he was like, we got up there, and he was just like, oh man, this is Glen Rose, like,
oh okay.
He was like, I would not expect to see that, you know, here or whatever, but it was a really high hilltop, I guess. And so anyway, that's all I know about that.
Okay.
Folks, moving on.
And now, you know, the rest of the story. So the Paluxy prints, the prints were made in mud that was much softer than where we were. So the prints in them are so, like, you know what it looks like when you make a print in deep mud. Your foot goes in, or any foot of whatever is making the print, it goes in, and then it sinks down so deep. And then when you pull the foot out, there's this suction action, and it kind of deforms the footprint.
Yeah.
Okay. That's not the case with the hominid prints in this flat that we found. They were running more across, like, say like mud that had mostly dried out, but was a little bit wet still, because you could see it was maybe like the bigger hominid prints maybe had imprinted, had indented it maybe an inch. You know, you can see the mud squeezed up in between the toes, but it didn't go over the toes.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what's fascinating about this, and why I think it's so important, is because these prints are actually much clearer, at least for the smaller hominid, like the hominid prints. This is the other thing. They don't like the standard model says that the prints at Paluxy River are not hominid prints, that they're degraded theropods prints. Okay. That they've been eroded and degraded, and now they look like human footprints, but they're not human footprints. And they can say that because of the way the mud has deformed, just the way the mud deformed the print in the first place. So when you look at the tracks that people think are human, they're all screwed up because they're actually deep in the mud. And so what you're seeing is like the ankle part, and, you know, and then the foot has to squeeze out of that, and it just has this weird deformed looking hole in the rock.
Yeah.
These prints we saw are not like that. Like, they're like what you would expect to see a human footprint in hard packed sand that like depressed a little bit when you stepped on it. It's almost a they're almost perfect prints. And you can look in the show notes. I'm going to put a whole bunch of these in the show notes.
And then the big ones are deep.
Are deep. Right. And they have flat bottoms.
And they're, well.
What?
I was going to say there's some of them that you can see these protrusions at the front, what would be the front of the print, that look like three, you know, clawed toes or whatever from a dinosaur.
Yes.
But what would be the points that would go between the toes towards the main body of the footprint have been kind of eroded away on, and some of them go in farther and then another one will be just kind of eroded away.
Yes. Some of them are degraded, but these prints are so high quality. I've spent a lot of time online, not just since this trip, but just in general, because I'm interested in this kind of stuff. I spent a lot of time online looking at fossil footprints of, you know, like there was the one period where I was like doing a lot of research on giants. So I was looking at what people thought were giant hominid prints. And then I was just looking at hominid prints in general, just trying to get a feel for what's out there. And then I'm looking at dinosaur footprints because Kyle and I found some in a state natural area near us. And so I was looking those up and just, so when when you go on Google Images and you look up fossils, you see the world-class like best fossils in the world. That's the first stuff Google shows you, is like these perfect, pristine like fossils of these amazing, you know. So I've seen the best footprints the world has to offer, at least that are in the public sphere, that have been published publicly. And these are up there with the best of them and are even better in most cases than anything I've ever seen.
Yeah. As far as the dinosaur footprints go, though, like the ones we found at Government Canyon State Natural Area are in better condition.
Yes.
I mean, and those were the theropod.
The theropods.
But there were some that were heavily degraded, like these that we saw.
Right. We found three like beautifully preserved, perfect theropod prints.
And that part of the river had been covered for a long time. And there had been a recent flood that had just pushed all the river gravel out of there.
Right.
And that's what exposed. And you could see like there were just these a couple of really awesome, perfect prints. And then it goes in. But you can continue to see the pattern left, right, left, right. But they get all screwed up you know, further down the river.
Right. And some of these were heavily eroded. A lot of the human prints, because this is the thing, the prints that were made by the hominids, and they looked like they were all of various types. You could see children. I mean, they were very clearly very small. I mean, maybe they weren't children. Maybe they were just small people. I don't know. But they were very small, like I would say 4 or 5 inches was the smallest one I found. With perfect, you could see the toes on it and the arch and the heel. And then there were ones that were enormous. Like Shaquille size, you know, Shaquille O'Neal size foots or bigger. Like, I'm just like, that's an enormous human footprint. Like, it's huge. I didn't have a measuring tape, so I can't give any measurements, but I would guess that some of them were 18 inches, maybe longer. Possibly, I don't know. Some of them were hard to tell because, like, and so I was looking last night at, like, what were the later, what are some of the big lizards we've had around here that were not, quote unquote, dinosaurs. There was a very large lizard that was like, I think he was Pliocene. Okay. And he has 5 toes and he may have made what I initially was thinking were maybe giant bear tracks, but this may have been this lizard guy because we also saw tail marks.
Yeah. It looked like tail dragging.
Yeah.
Swipes in the rock.
Right.
So. And then the interesting thing about those, you know, you look at this groove in the rock, and it could be a gouge made by some boulder rolling along in the riverbed during a flood, except that they're going the wrong way.
Yeah.
They're like at an angle to the direction that the river would actually flow. So it's kind of – and they're consistently that way.
Right.
So it's like, why is there
all these very similar gouges
going that direction?
Also, I noticed that the prints did not seem to follow. Like, we kept seeing them in the canyon as we went up the canyon, but they didn't seem to actually follow the canyon. And, like, some of them would very noticeably go underneath shelves of rock.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think it almost – like, I started to think that the canyon wasn't there when these people were making these prints. Like, they were running on a flat plain that had recently been drained of water and left this mud.
Yeah.
And I said running because a lot of them were on their toes. Like it's a clearly, it's a running profile. When somebody's sprinting or running, their heels rarely impact, and it's mostly toes. And there was a lot of that where you would just see the toes, and then the big toe would flick, like would come up out of the stuff and flick material forward, and you could see that little scoop that it had made.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm talking about like I said, these are mind blowing world class prints. And my mind is still exploding from this. Like, I'm just going to have to gather my brain from the inside of the tangent cube and try to talk about this more. But and we've got other subjects to talk about too. But we're gonna go take a break, and I'm gonna try to pick up my brain off the sides of the walls, and we'll come back.
You could scoop it up with a snake. Snake scooping brains.
A serpent scoop for brains. Unstoppable pursuit of the lithification of defecation. Brother the Serpent Podcast.
Corporalites.
Looking for ancient shit. So, this whole trip we went on has gotten me thinking about Huyatlaco. So, I have this article from Mysterious Universe about the Huyatlaco site. And how it's controversial and arrowheads and stuff like that. So,
all right, let's go hear it.
Yeah. So this is from mysteriousuniverse.org, guys. Great site. Lots of excellent articles. And you will see me in the comments kicking people's asses. One of the longest standing debates in modern archaeology deals with the mystery of human arrival in the Americas. Such mysterious human migrations were once thought to have conclusively rested on the premise that early human hunter-gatherers crossed the Bering land bridge en route from Siberia, entering the North American continent and dispersing outward from there. However, the possibility that multiple entry points might have occurred via ancient seafarers who sailed all along the western coastlines cannot be ruled out. The same must be said of those more controversial theories involving ancient sailors from Europe, possibly members of the Sultrian culture, making their way across the Atlantic and entering from the Northeast. In likelihood, there were many cultures and people who entered North America in the ancient past, arriving from a much wider variety of locations than once thought. What brought them to the Americas may remain somewhat mysterious, although it seems evident that the ancient quest for sustenance pushed them onward, and the discovery of lands rich with vegetation and, of course, megafauna, kept them there. However, wait a minute. Look at those giant cats. I'm going to stay. However, one of the greatest and most perplexing questions about their arrival that remains has to do with who were the first arrivals, and more specifically, when did they arrive? The presence of the archaeological sites associated with the Clovis culture, as well as a growing number of sites that present evidence of even earlier habitation, have continued to push back the timeline on early human arrival in the Americas. Along the best evidence for such discoveries have been bifacial stone tools, that is, projectile points or stone knives worked with both faces on the blade. Worked on both faces of the blade. Discovered throughout North and South America, often found alongside or in situ with extinct animal remains. The earliest and still among the most famous of these had been discoveries of megafaunal butchering sites at Folsom in New Mexico, which is what Folsom points are associated right. with. That's where they're always called after the first place they were found. So Clovis was found in Clovis, New Mexico. Now they're found all over the Americas. They're called Clovis points. Same thing with Folsom. these established the thusly named Clovis and Folsom cultures in the early part of the last century. Yeah, okay, so the names were established in the last part of the early part of the last century. I was like, wait, those cultures are a lot older than that. However, evidence of earlier lithic types also turn up in the mix from time to time. In 1967, a most unusual artifact turned up at a Mexican archaeological site at
Do it.
Tlapacoya.
Oh, that sounded great.
Just south of Mexico City, the stone blade made of obsidian was radiocarbon dated to around 21,000 BCE, which is before Common Era, which basically just means BC, and helped establish the existence of Mesoamerican pre-bifacial point horizon in the region. So Mesoamerican pre-bifacial point horizon. You guys got that?
So what they're saying is that this thing is what,
21,000 BC.
Okay.
So 23,000 years old.
So they think that the Paleolithic era, is that right?
Yeah.
Is 12,000, starting at 12,000 years ago.
Yeah.
Roughly, or 12,000 BC.
Right.
Or something.
Yeah. That's right.
And this one is almost twice that.
Yes, but almost twice that.
It's bifacial?
It's bifacial, yeah.
Is it
stone blade made of obsidian helped establish the existence of a Mesoamerican pre-bifacial point horizon. So I guess they're saying it's unifacial. I don't know. Pre-bifacial?
Okay.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. So what they're basically saying is this point established what they now consider the earliest bifacial point.
Okay.
So pre-bifacial point horizon means that before this, they think they were all unifacials.
Okay.
Yeah.
That makes sense, yeah.
Glad we parsed that, because it was a little bit confusing. Okay. But this is further suggesting that much earlier occupations of the regions in the region were there. Let's see. Further suggesting much earlier occupations of the regions than once thought. Okay. Tlapacoya was not the only location in the region that presented unusual ancient discoveries. Near Puebla, in what is called the Vasiquillo region of Mexico, excavations similarly turned up unifacially worked stone tools that dated back to at least 21,800 years BCE. So 23,800 years ago. Okay.
Yeah.
Those are unifacials. The Vasiquillo region, despite its confirmed antiquity, has remained somewhat controversial in archaeological circles. And also remember that the Clovis First people, which has been the standard model for the past 150 years, it's just now starting to kind of fade away because they found too much evidence against it. But the Clovis First people considered that all peoples that came into the Americas are the first people, the Clovis people, came across the land bridge.
Mm-hmm.
So people being down in Mexico already, that's too fast, right? People in butt flaps and sandals can't walk to Mexico that fast because the Bering Land Bridge is up there by Alaska.
Okay.
And you can't walk down to Mexico. You know, they think that they migrated there very slowly over thousands of years. So,
but they think they came across the land bridge
very quickly.
No, but I mean,
running from ice.
12 to 13,000 years ago, right?
Yeah. But there's a consideration that there was a window, right? Okay. So 12 to 13,000 years ago was when Clovis ended. So the Clovis Clovis people died out at the end of the last ice age. They were killed off at the end of the Younger Dryas. Okay, so the window of their passage into the Americas has never been perfectly clear, but it's ranged. It's given a range of a lot of time.
Okay.
Okay, so 20,000 years BCE is not it's stretching it. It's pushing it for them crossing the bridge. It's too early for them to be in Mexico. That's why it's controversial, okay? Okay. So 21,800 years BCE is not an inconceivable time period for early human habitation, nor is it by any means the earliest suggested time of human settlement in the Americas. Recent controversial discoveries at the Cerruti Mastodon site in Southern California were the latest to argue a much earlier human presence in North America, going as far back as 130,000 years, which would place them in the depths of the Ice Age. Actually previous to the warming before this one. So the Ice Age has been a long deal, and it would go through this, like there would be interglacials and then glacial and interglacial. So there was an interglacial – we're in an interglacial right now that's lasting way too long, right? So going back to 12,000 BC, you go into the glacial.
Yeah.
Okay, and the glacial period grows – and remember, we're going back in time, so it's slightly confusing. But the glacial period goes up – in other words, ice amounts go up and up and up and up as you get back 25,000 years, 50,000 years – to 100,000 years, and then you start going back down into the previous interglacial. So 130,000 years ago would put them
at an interglacial,
like coming up out of their interglacial and into the highest period of the glacial that ended at the end of the Younger Dryas.
Okay,
that's my knowledge. Don't totally quote me on that. We don't have the show observer here to correct everything that I'm getting wrong.
Yeah.
All right. Understandably, most of the archaeological community simply cannot accept this. It's not really understandable, but yeah, they do. and the veracity of the alleged evidence of the human butchering found at the site remains in dispute. So in other words, they found bones of extinct megafauna from those periods that have scratch marks that are definitely from tools.
Mm-hmm.
Well, people say that they're not definitely from tools, but they're scratch marks and they're not from teeth.
Yeah.
Right. Well, you know, it fell down a cliff and then it rolled and rolled and rolled and all of its, and then it decayed and it was still rolling and then the bones got scratched and it was still rolling and sure guy, whatever. However, decades before the recent discoveries in California, a more obscure Mexican site at Vasaquillo managed to arouse a similar controversy for boasting an even greater potential antiquity for humans in the region. Perhaps going more than 100,000 years earlier than that which has been claimed for the Cerruti site.
So that's 230,000 years.
That's right. The Huyatlaco, it's very difficult to say. It's spelled H-U-E-Y-A-T-L-A-C-O. Huyatlaco. The Huyatlaco archaeological site, also found in the Vasaquillo Basin near Puebla, Mexico, achieved notoriety following excavations which began there in 1962, carried out by Cynthia Irwin Williams. Okay, so another deal with Cynthia, or with this, is that... This was the 60s, and Cynthia Irwin Williams was the very first female archaeologist to head a dig. Okay, so the Skirptards used that to debunk the site. Yeah.
Losers.
Yeah.
They're mice. Snakes eat them.
She was the co-discoverer of the site with Juan Arminia Camacho. The excavations carried out in association with the U.S. Geological Survey, which is very well respected, okay, recovered a number of... It's very well respected, okay?
Yeah.
It's very well respected, my boy. Some of the... so they recovered a number of stone tools, some of which were discovered in situ alongside animal remains. Virginia Steen McIntyre, a graduate student at the time, joined the excavation team during continuing excavations in 1966 following a request of Harold E. Mald, the on-site geologist. Steen McIntyre would later become known for being associated with the site, to her great detriment, unfortunately. Among the most controversial of the ancient tools recovered from Huyatlaco were those discovered in situ with the pelvis bone of a camel. Now, there were camels in the Americas previous to the end of the last ice age. Radiocarbon dating and geochronological analysis of the site carried out during the 1960s excavations led the archaeologist there to a startling determination. That Huyatlaco, the scientists believe, dated as far back as 250,000 years BP. Okay, so that's BP just means...
Before present. Right.
Right. Start counting from now and go back 250,000 years.
Start counting from the 60s and go back.
Right. Specifically, the stratum where artifacts were recovered, according to radiocarbon dating, were found to be more than 35,000 years old. Uranium dating of the same regions found dates believed to be 260,000 years before present.
Damn.
Shortly after publication of these findings, archaeologists in the region attempted to dispute the finds, suggesting that artifacts might have been planted at the location by local farmers. An assertion for which there appeared to be little corroborating evidence.
Because farmers have time to dig huge holes and stick artifacts in there and then bury them.
Watch how we trick these archaeologists, wait.
Yeah.
A less conspiratorial suggestion from the greater archaeological community held that with the prevalence of fluvial deposits and flooding at the site, contamination of the stratums used for testing seemed more likely. This position is maintained by the majority of Skirpturbs today. Archaeologists, sorry. According to the later study that was published in 1981 by Virginia Steen McIntyre, Roald Freixel, and Harold E. Mald, examination through tracing of the stream beds at the site performed during excavations carried out in May of 1973 showed that they were present beneath 10 meters of water-laid deposits. Bifacial tools were discovered in the oldest of four units at the site, located within a channel covered by stream deposits. So this gets a little confusing because there's a big stream that was old. Okay, so it was dried up. But there's also a volcano associated with this. And in the stream and in the bank associated with the stream, there was volcanic ash. I think they'll get into that in the article. Okay, here's some of the samples.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I would have picked that up. If I'd have seen it.
Based on this information, the study's authors concluded the following. Fission track ages on zircon phenocrysts from two of the younger tephra layers, which are 370,000 to 200,000, and 370,000 plus or minus 200,000, and 600,000 plus or minus 340,000. Those are, so that's the the error possibility on the dates based on this zircon or the fission track. They got better dating later. Okay. These agree with the concordant uranium series dates for a camel pelvis that was found associated with bifacial tools at Huyatlaco. The dates are compatible with the depth of burial and subsequent dissection of the Huyatlaco deposits, as well as with the degree of hydration of the volcanic glass shards and with the extent of etching of heavily mined mineral finfrists from within the tephra layers. So they're just talking geology there. These findings suggest to us that further search for archaeological remains and deposits as old as those at Huyatlaco would be warranted. Of course, Huyatlaco remains an item of heavy dispute within the archaeological community, since dates as early as those suggested at the site push back the timeline of human presence in the Americas by not just thousands, but potentially hundreds of thousands of years. Even with the level of academic rigor that has been applied at the site since the 1960s, conventional attitudes among archaeologists are far from near being able to accept no such claims, particularly in the absence of other locations that would offer convincing evidence of similar antiquity, because, of course, they won't dig that far down. I added that last part myself. What they're saying is, they always point to, well, nothing else has been found like that anywhere in the Americas. I'm like, yeah, because you stopped digging at Clovis. Dumbass. Sorry. Okay, it is worth noting this brings us back to locales like the Cerruti Mastodon site in Southern California, a location believed by excavators to represent far more recent early human presence, though one that still falls far from hitting the mark of credibility with most academicians. Academicians? Perhaps with time, at least some of these early anomalous archaeological sites will be revisited and eventually confirmed as having shown evidence for much earlier arrivals and settlements in the West than most would have ever expected. Until that time, Huyatlaco will remain an anomaly and one of the several footnotes of the contentious ongoing debate about the earliest human arrivals in the New World. And they don't tell you this in this article, but Huyatlaco was flooded by a reservoir very recently after the site was more recently examined in the 70s. So they went back in the 70s, the geologists did more research, they found more accurate dating, and then they got this physicist to do uranium, thorium, helium dating, which was very, very accurate, and found it to be – he dated it to – 280,000 years, and it's very precise because he's using three different markers, uranium, helium, thorium, or whatever it is. I can't remember exactly what it's called. But he basically looks for crystal. He looks for like scars and crystals that alpha particles, like heavy neutrons, make as the uranium sheds them in alpha radiation. These massive neutrons go flying through the crystal and make a scar. And he can see those with an electron scanning microscope.
That's freaking awesome.
And they could program the microscope to count the scars. Okay, and he's doing this in volcanic deposits, right? So the idea is that the crystals formed after the volcanic deposits cooled. So you can – and then the uranium started to scar the crystals. So you can date it based on how many – so they had this idea of –
they have a standardized
idea of constants of decay, so that, and the idea with the decay is that we can point to a million uranium atoms and we can say we don't know which one of these will decay, but we know that half of them will decay in this amount of time.
Yeah.
Right. Given that the rate of decay is a constant, which it probably is over short periods of time. So since with the material we're looking at, we know formed a crystal after the volcano had the volcano erupted and then it cooled, he can then count the scars in those crystals and figure out when it was formed, because we know he can count backwards.
When it cooled.
Right.
Yeah, basically.
So the Huyatlaco points were found under that. So the dating of 280,000 years is the volcano layer above them.
Right.
So the idea is that this has to be this old or older. Okay, because none of the tools obviously were found in the volcanic layer of ash. The people that were living there either ran or died from the volcano eruption. And they stopped living there and stopped making tools. Okay.
That's freaking awesome.
And so after they went back and did all this in the 70s, somebody decided that this would be a great site for a reservoir and flooded the whole area.
Yeah.
Sound familiar, folks? So that's Huyatlaco, and it was cool. They mentioned a couple of the other sites. Now, one of the Joe Rogan shows with Graham Hancock and Randall Carlson that was more recent, the one where they debated Michael Shermer and that other Skriptard, they talked about these sites, and now that they're being actually – that there's not Huyatlaco, but the one that they talked about with the Macedon bones has been much more recently scrutinized, and people are like, okay, we're going to have to accept this. We can't debunk it anymore. So there is an agreement now that there were people here for whatever reason, however they got here, that are 130,000 years ago. But Huyatlaco pushes it back to 280,000 plus.
Yeah.
And since it was a woman, like, and none of this was in the article, which is interesting to me, but there's a whole documentary on the Huyatlaco site that's just really well done. That tells you all the details of all the drama that the entire academic community just came out after them. The woman that was running the site was just reviled, and they used the fact that she was a woman and didn't know how to do science and blah, blah, blah. This is all bullshit. And she was like getting her emotions get a control of her. And then Virginia McIntyre, Steen McIntyre, the like who specialized in geological dating. That was her specialty. And she had like gone to college and learned all the newest science of the day of dating with geology. And then the guy that she was working with, the other dude, Malde or whatever his name was a world renowned expert at diatom dating, which mm-hmm. is very rare, but incredibly accurate, considered to be incredibly accurate because diatoms, they're specific species and they're found in layers or whatever. So he went through all this rigmarole with like getting soil samples and figuring out what diatoms were in there. And he was able to date the site and it matched the physics guy's date. And Virginia Steen McIntyre did her dating and she did four different kinds of the newest types, most up-to-date technological dating that was like badass at the time, and they all of those correlated with each other, and she was never able to get a job doing that ever again.
Golly, man. Ugh.
And that was her first job out of graduate school, basically. She got accepted to this job, and she thought it was a great opportunity. Like, wow, this is great. We're changing science. And nope, she has never been able to get a job doing what she went to school for ever again since then. She's now an old woman.
Screw them.
Yeah. So that lets you know, that shows you the power of the Skerptard community. But you're right. Snake Bros Snake Force is growing, and they are mice, and we will eat them.
Heck yeah.
So.
And they can't really destroy your credentials if you don't have any. So get out there, Snake Force.
That's right. Get out there, Snake Force. Don't worry about your credentials being destroyed because you have none. They can't destroy your reputation when you don't have one.
That's right.
They're like, I mean, what can they say? We sit around in rivers named after the devil and drink hundreds of beers. They can't really trash you after you've done that.
That's right, dude.
We fully admit it. That's right.
Man.
So what do you think? Let's do some speculation here. What do you think the Americas was? Was it like the fabled like Atlantis? Was it the land of Mu? Was it the place where all this knowledge came from a long time ago before all these cataclysms? Or is it somewhere where people have been trying to get to and getting lost and dying in for the past 200,000 years?
I actually tend to lean towards the quote-unquote Atlantis idea.
But I do, too.
The idea not necessarily being that there was some big badass city that sank into the sea or the ocean or whatever, but that previous to the end of the last ice age, that there was possibly a high civilization here. Yeah, and when I say that, several. I don't know what that means exactly. Like when I talk about, you know, high technology or whatever,
it was made of long heads and they were going to space.
Yeah, I'm not necessarily saying space flight and cell phones and
yeah,
internet,
crystal technology.
But just looking at how, like, all of this data about the cataclysm that whatever it was that caused the end of the last ice age and how it just completely, you know, wiped the slate clean here.
Yeah.
We don't know what could have been here, except there's all of this stuff. Like, while you were reading that article, once again, I'm faced with this problem that, you know, we're talking about constants. And of course, you mentioned in a short amount of time, they're probably correct about that. But the whole like geological dating of stratigraphy is based on a whole bunch of stacks of assumptions again.
Exactly.
And you know, we're just now starting to scratch the surface with detailed analysis of what this, what aside from the uniformitarian explanation of the end of the last ice age was, what it could have possibly been,
right,
in terms of a cataclysm. And the fact that the majority of the scientific community does not accept cataclysms.
Yeah.
It's just, it's like
global cataclysms anyway. Yeah.
Yeah. It's, I can't, none of it makes sense anymore.
Right. Right.
And it never did, but it's like the more you find out about what the other, you know, yeah, what the alternative ideas or what the alternative findings are, the data that they won't look at, the data, right, that they poo-poo because, oh, they didn't know how to date stuff or it was not in situ or
right,
whatever.
That was a woman running that site.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just all of that. It's to me, there's no question that the standard model is wrong.
Right.
I don't know what the right answer is.
Right.
But to me, wait, they have it wrong.
Yes, I agree with that.
What? Wait, what?
I'm just like, you're like, they have it wrong. I'm like, right, wait.
So I, you know, we have, based on the standard model, all of the ideas about what was going on in South and Central America and who the builders of all that stuff were. I don't think that's right. We have all of the colonial root cellars that I don't think that's right. We don't know who built them.
Jim Vieira impression.
We have
there.
Paluxy River footprints that they poo-poo. I don't believe that.
Right.
The stuff that you found.
Yeah.
Like, it's the dating of the Huyatlaco site. The fact that some farmer boy found some freaking ancient metal pages of something was the,
yeah,
you know, like all of that stuff. The red-headed giants in Lovelock Cave.
Lovelock Cave, yep.
All of
the
stories,
red-headed braided people in China, like all that stuff.
All of the stories from the Hopi and
yeah, the Navajo and the moon-eyed people, the
cliff dwellings in New Mexico. Just it's like the Grand Canyon, for Christ's sake, people.
The Grand Canyon.
And the, you know, the ancient,
and the Grand Canyon is, I'm sorry, but the Grand Canyon
Egyptians
is clearly two, if you look at it, there's a huge one and then there's a smaller one. That's what's crazy to me is like it was clearly two giant inundations. There's like a massive one and then there's also a massive one, but it's smaller than the first one that's inside of the big one. It's
yeah,
crazy.
Previous and after the Younger Dryas.
That's right. The one that happened first and the one that happened second.
But, you know, there's the finds of Egyptian hieroglyphic carvings or writings or whatever in the Northeast.
And in Australia. Yeah.
So it seems to me that there was a civilization or multiple civilizations that circumnavigated the globe. They were seafarers. They visited the coastal regions all over the world.
Yeah.
And all over the world, you look at what's going on in the coastal regions and there's crazy massive megalithic construction all the way up Peru, you know, all the way up South American coastlines, basically.
Yeah.
All the way from Antarctica like that. I don't know.
And then there's the dating of, okay. Yeah. So now you're getting me thinking about it. The dating of the guy who went and looked at Tiwanaku, the massive megalithic site by Lake Titicaca in Peru, the Tiwanaku and Pumapunku.
Yeah.
And he did all the dating on that and discovered, and like his was based on alignments, right? And he was like, this site is between 45,000 and 25,000 years old based on the fact that it's off alignment to what he thought was the Milankovitch cycles, the different tilts of the planet, the nod of the, you know. So that puts that. And then Gunung Padang is supposed to be the geologist that did the core drilling. They pulled it out in the bottom layer. They were saying 35,000 years old.
Right.
Yeah, you're right.
Same with the Sphinx. I mean, like the oldest, you know, Robert Schock started out the most conservative dating of the Sphinx.
Yeah.
Was
7,000 to 9,000 years.
Right. And now it's like it could be 35,000 years old.
Yeah.
That there's a window there that matches.
Yep. That's right. Which would put it like John Anthony West said before he died, into the previous, like Yuga ages, like the previous, not the beginning of the year that like we're the in, but the year. One, yeah, the one before that.
Right.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think there are massive secrets to be found in the Americas, and because
people have thought that there aren't, that it's almost like low hanging fruit.
That's what we call low hanging fruit, right?
That's
there.
Right, low hanging fruit.
It's just there, ready to be discovered.
Right, and if you don't pick it, it's going to fall, and you're going to slip on it.
Yeah,
which is what's been happening to them over and over. They keep slipping on these anomalous bananas of low hanging fruit. And it slips them up, and they're like, well, that didn't happen. That totally didn't happen. That's not a banana.
Yeah. And honestly, like, I don't care anymore what, you know, what the standard modelist people, uniformitarians believe. Like, it's just none of it lines up. None of it adds up. They throw out all the evidence against it and call it outliers.
Right.
And now it's like that evidence is mounting so ridiculously high. The outlier wall is bigger than the freaking their whole stack of assumptions.
Right. But we'll keep pointing out what they think on this show so that we can say,
hold up, wait a minute, something ain't right.
Yeah.
Because that's really the idea. Like, I know, you know, a lot of times I'll be telling Kyle about something. And I'll be like, yeah, bro, and blah, 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 blah. And I'll tell him about how it doesn't fit the standard model. And he's like, yeah, so what? It's not, he doesn't get excited about that. I'm like, what? Oh, yeah. Dang it. This happens to me with GMA, too. I'm like, but, you know, the standard model says this. And he's like, yeah, but the standard model is wrong. I'm like, yeah, you're right. You're not excited about that. I get it.
Yeah, it's probably all the years of debating the standard modelists online where it's like you want to kick their ass and keep kicking right. their ass. And like,
I'm like, look at this new point to kick their ass. You're like, yeah, we know they're wrong, bro. this debate is over as far as we're concerned. Why are you even talking about the standard model? Well, because, dang it.
But at the same time, it's like, you know, this trip that we took and everything that we saw there, that's what's so awesome about it is the mystery. You know, when you go there and you're just like, oh yeah, we know how old this is, we know how they built it, we know why they were here, we know what they did, and we know where they went, and we know whatever. It's just boring.
you're right. Why don't you grab that alabaster head? That's probably who was buried in it. Part of that story just blew my mind. Like, they found the head somewhere near the site and they're like, yeah, that's probably the guy that was buried in it. Yeah. Like, what?
Yeah.
The assumptions, the stacks become larger and larger. Like the show observer says, load-bearing holes. They have load-bearing holes in their theory. The holes are so enormous that they become load-bearing of the theory that it's stacked on top of them.
Yeah.
And you can't mess with those holes because then the whole theory will fall apart. All right. So that's it for this segment. We'll come back for the last segment and we'll close it out. We'll try to tie all this together into a giant snake.
Science.
Wait a minute. What?
Snake Force. Something ain't right. We're back for the final segment of the final hour
of Snake Force Podcast.
Pyramids. Dolmens.
Magnets.
It's all a house of cards, folks. That standard murder. The standard murder.
Hermigerd. The standard murder.
So now that we've been out in the field once again, it is just even more clear that
nothing is clear.
Is not clear. That's really what we're laying out here.
That's right.
But what else you got? You got another story you're gonna.
I do. Since we're going through these mysteries of the Americas, this is great. And we were finding strange rocks, strange and anomalous rocks. We have the bizarre and mysterious rocks of New England. Now this is cool because, as you guys may remember, I spent some time in Vermont. And that's in the area. This is in the area of where I was staying, basically. Okay, so this is also on mysteriousuniverse.org. And this is a very recent article. This was written on the 15th of this month by Brent Swanser. The New England region is the eastern United States is a place of deep history, struggle, and indeed many mysteries. Here we can find all manner of ghost stories and strange tales, and it is a wellspring of the paranormal and the bizarre. Among such tales are the many enigmatic and baffling rocks that dot the landscape here, which cover, I think the guy lives there, which cover everything from historical oddities to the outlandishly paranormal. One of the weirdest mystery rocks of the New England region supposedly lies at Glastonbury Mountain, also called Green Mountain, near Bennington, Vermont. Remember the Bennington Triangle?
Mm.
It's one of the active disappearing regions where people just... The area has long been a treasure trove of strangeness, including mystery lights, ghosts, Bigfoot sightings, and other various unexplained phenomena, and the native peoples of the region long avoided this as a cursed place. Perhaps most famously, there was a series of bizarre disappearances that took place over a five-year period between 1945 and 1950, which have remained unsolved and have earned the region the ominous nickname the Bennington Triangle. See? It's always triangles, people. Giant yep. stone triangles, giant disappearing triangles.
Yep.
The first vanishing occurred in November of 1945 when experienced hunter and guide Mitty Rivers was with a group of hunters when he rounded a bend and seemingly stepped right off the face of the earth. The only clue that would ever be found was a single bullet beside a stream. The following year, on December 1st, 1946, 18-year-old Paula Jean Weldon was hiking at Glastonbury Mountain when she, too, vanished without a trace. Two witnesses reported being right behind her on the trail, and she rounded a corner, but when the couple reached the same spot where the young woman had been, she was nowhere to be seen and has never been seen since, despite extensive searches across the years.
Hmm.
That was one of the ones, like, when I was first reading about disappearances, that one disturbed me because it was like she walked around a big rock, and a few seconds later, the couple walked around the big rock, and she was nowhere to be found, and she was never seen again, and she still has not ever been found. And no trace of her, not a single piece of clothing, no tooth.
That's crazy.
Like, it's very hard. This is why I have the six-second rule. Like, it only takes 6 seconds for you to disappear off the face of the fucking planet. I pull up to the top in the dark, and I get out of my car, and no one's there, and I'm like, I have 6 seconds to get inside.
But when you're in a canyon and you're like, I left my radio in the car, you're like, I'm going to do it anyway.
I'm totally fine. I can be cool. Yeah, because you know, I'm smart. We all know we're dumb on this show. The spate of unsolved disappearances continued in 1949 when, in December of that year, James E. Tetford boarded a bus bound for Bennington but never got off. His luggage and an open bus timetable were found, but Tetford has never been seen again, even though passengers remember seeing him on the bus when it departed. And it is as if he just blinked out of existence. I remember talking about that one on this show, too. The guy gets on the bus. The bus does – it's a nonstop. He gets on the bus, puts his stuff down, sits down in the seat. And then when they get to the destination, when they haven't stopped, he's gone. His stuff's still there, and he has never been found.
Yeah, that's
– I remember telling the story, and you're like, I'm trying to figure out, like, how could he have done it?
Like, yeah, yeah.
He's like crawling underneath the bus and snuck out the door and went into the bathroom and pulled the emergency thing and went down in the toilet and got out of the tank. The following year, little 8-year-old Paul Jepson was sitting in the family truck when his mother went to feed some pigs. When she returned, he was gone. And an extensive search turned up no sign of him except a scent trail followed by dogs into the woods that just stopped. That same year, Frida Langer was hiking with her cousin near a place called Somerset Reservoir when she slipped and fell. She told her cousin to continue on and that she would catch up later, but she never did, and she disappeared without a trace. Her body would be found several months later in an area that had been thoroughly searched, and it would be the last of the Bennington Triangle disappearances. And he says, I have gone into more detail on these vanishings here, and he has a link to his other article about that. So, in the years since, there have been theories on these vanishings too numerous to go into here, ranging from Bigfoot attacks to UFOs to interdimensional doorways. and everything in between. But one of the most unusual of these was put forward by the author and paranormal researcher Joseph Citro, who incidentally was the one who first coined the term Bennington Triangle. In his 2009 book, The Vermont Monster Guide, Citro suggested that these people may have fallen victim to a mysterious carnivorous rock from native folklore that was said to actually swallow people whole. A carnivorous rock.
Whoa.
Now, before you guys think that that's just craziness, there are things that are very much like carnivorous rocks in the ocean. They're called grouper fish. They look exactly like a boulder until they eat you.
Yeah.
Okay, so don't poo-poo that too much, okay? According to legend, it was a large boulder in appearance, but if that person were to lean against it or step upon its surface, it would swiftly and hungrily absorb them. And natives were very wary of the area because of this predatory boulder. Citro would write of this man-eating rock thus, "No one alive has seen this dangerous anomaly on Glastonbury Mountain. Native Americans knew of it and warned people away. We can only imagine it as a sizable rock, large enough to stand on. But when somebody stands upon it, the rock becomes less solid and, like a living thing, swallows the unfortunate trespasser. A number of disappearances have been reported on Glastonbury Mountain. Could all of these vanished folks have stepped inadvertently onto these hungry stones?" While the man-eating rock of Glastonbury Mountain may only exist in myth and legend, there are other mysterious rocks in New England that are very much real, if no less enigmatic. Equally wreathed in spooky legends and folklore is a large rock located in North Manchester, Maine, that according to legend holds the footprints of the devil himself. The rock itself appears to have imprinted within it three footprints, with two looking human and another appearing as if it is a cloven hoof. The story behind this strange anomaly is that the first early settlers of Manchester were trying to build a road through the area, and they encountered many large boulders and rocks blocking their path. What?
So
they found the rock?
Made footprints?
Footprints? I think what he's trying to say is that they found it.
Okay.
I'm not sure.
All right.
According to the tale, somewhere in the vicinity of what is now the Case Cemetery, the construction workers came across a particularly intimidating and massive boulder. All attempts to move it proved fruitless, and the crew became worried that they wouldn't be able to go through it at all, and that would thwart the whole project. So one of the workers purportedly proclaimed that he would sell his soul if that damned rock would just get out of the freaking way. Apparently, the next day, the rock was indeed moved some distance away, and etched upon it were those three footprints as a record of the deal. Spookily, the man who had, quote, sold his soul was nowhere to be found, gone without a trace. The footprints themselves, with two human-like and one cloven, have been explained as either those of the devil changing shape or, more sinisterly, evidence etched in stone of the demon chasing the man to claim his payment in soul. This may sound all like pure folklore, but the cemetery whose wall the rock in question is now a part of has had its fair share of paranormal happenings over the years. Suddenly, sudden temperature drops, shadowy figures, and strange sounds and lights coming from the cemetery are par for the course. More often than not, right in the vicinity of this anomalous rock. That cemetery has actually become quite a hotbed of the paranormal, and one wonders if it has, if the devil's footprint has anything to do with it. Whatever the case may be, it is a spooky legend, to be sure. And there's a picture of the rock right here. And the footprints are kind of, like, highlighted in so that you can see them.
Yeah.
But that looks like granite to me.
It kind of reminds me of the story you read about the Ouija board. So I'm thinking along the lines of like once something happens and people focus on that as something paranormal or spiritual or, you know, whatever, then the occurrences
ramp up.
Exactly. So it's kind of like, I'm not trying to poo-poo this. So what the guy was saying about the Ouija board, you know, everybody's got their hands on it and their intentions may cause their bodies to make some weird, you know, unconscious twitches and movements, which ultimately spell out a word that answers a question.
Right.
And he, you know, the idea I'm having about that is that that's not necessarily something to explain it away. That could also be, like evidence to the fact that there is something
strange
more,
going on.
There is something strange that enough people focusing an intention, like you were saying, to open a doorway, could cause some strange otherworldly occurrences. So, like this guy, whoever he was, that wanted this to happen,
yeah,
you know, whatever his intention was, you know,
It is interesting that he disappears too afterwards.
Right. It causes it to happen. And then the fact that he disappears
makes it more weird.
Yeah. Right. And so a bunch of people start focusing on it. And then, of course, it becomes part of a cemetery wall. And then even more stuff, you know, and it's like, it's, you know.
Wait, are you going to bury me next to the Devil Rock? Can that not happen, please?
I don't want to go to hell. And like, he already stepped there. So can I not be buried next to that rock, please?
Can I not be buried next to that?
Yeah, I get what you're saying. That's a good point. It's sort of like, I think maybe another example of that is like the sort of the healing relics. Like there's a relic of some saint and people believe that if they touch it, they're healed. And that may be because there's some power in the relic, or it may be because they believe it.
Yeah, well, that's kind of like the way I look at a talisman. A talisman has power because people give it that power.
Right.
And you're giving something power whether you want to or not if you believe in it.
Right. And each time somebody goes up to be healed by this relic and they see like crutches and walkers and other things like left there because people were healed, then that strengthens the whole thing and it keeps being more powerful. Yeah. Yeah. But the devil really did step on that rock. I'm just saying. It's totally the devil's footprint on there. The guy was definitely running away from him. And he didn't make it. Okay. Other mystery rocks seem to represent anomalous history and hint at the existence of mysterious ancient peoples. One of the most well-known of these is a massive 40-ton, 11-foot-long boulder originally located in the riverbed of the Taunton River at Berkeley, Massachusetts, which is covered in ancient petroglyphs and writing of unknown origin that have been baffling experts for centuries. And baffling. They're always baffled. It's always that word. They're baffled. The rock was described in Reverend Cotton Mather's 1690 book, The Wonderful Works of God Commemorated. Thus, among the other curiosities of New England, one is that of a mighty rock on a perpendicular side whereof by a river, which at high tide covers part of it. There are very deeply engraved, no man alive knows how or when, about half a score of lines, near 10 foot long and a foot and a half broad, filled with strange characters, which would suggest as odd thoughts about them that were here before us as there are odd shapes in that elaborate monument. Man, that guy's got a tangled mind, doesn't he? Just straighten out your sentences, buddy. There's weird shit in that rock. That's all you need to say. The origins of the geometric shapes, drawings, and writings etched upon the rock are just as much a mystery today as they were back then. In 1963, Dighton Rock was removed and placed in a museum at nearby Dighton State Park for preservation and study, and despite being analyzed by numerous scientists and archaeologists over the years, no one is really certain who made the markings or what they mean. The petroglyphs have managed to elude understanding, its writings and symbols undecipherable, and the rock has sparked all manner of speculation ranging from the rational to the decidedly fringe, such as that they were left by pre-Columbian Norse, Phoenician, Portuguese, or Chinese explorers, that they were merely made by the native people of the area, or even that they were made by aliens, or they are an actual message from actual God. In the end, no one knows, and the Dighton Rock has gone on to become a legendary unsolved mystery. This is sort of like the Judicola Stone.
The
other mysterious rock with crazy paintings on it that I talked about, that the giant,
like the threw down in the valley. Okay, that's what I was going to ask. Is that the same one?
No, it's not. This is Dighton Rock. It's a different one. The other one's called the Judicola Rock or whatever. Somewhat similar to Dighton Rock is another large boulder located in North Kingstown, Rhode Island, called the Quidneset Rock. Also the Narragansett Runestone, discovered half buried in the mud flats of Narragansett Bay in 19... I'm probably butchering that name. Narragansett? Yeah, maybe that's it. Narragansett Bay in 1984. The 2.5-ton boulder is not nearly as large as Dighton Rock, but it similarly bears numerous strange symbols or runes of mysterious origins. The stone has gone on to be studied by various institutes such as the Rhode Island Historical Preservation and Heritage Commission, the New England Antiquities Research Association, and the University of Rhode Island School of Oceanography, but answers have remained evasive, to say the least. Theories include that it is some sort of ancient pre-Columbian Viking carving, or that it was a marker created by the Knights Templar in ancient times, but it is far from clear, and the stone has drawn in droves of curiosity seekers over the years. So many people came to the mudflats looking for the rock, in fact, that one local man actually stole it in 2012 and dropped it into deeper waters for the purpose of keeping the tourists away.
Oh my God.
He went spelunking with this rock. The runestone was eventually recovered the following year and put on display at Updike Park in the quiet village of Wickford, where it has continued to puzzle all who try to understand it. Making matters of its origins murkier is that in 2014, a man named Everett Brown came forward to say the markings on the Narragansett stone were a practical joke carried out by him and his brother in 1964. Although this is disputed and is likely a hoax itself.
Jeez.
And they have a picture of the runestone here, but it's difficult to see the runes on it from the angle of the picture. Yet another mysterious rock is a strange object that was dug up one day in 1872 as a fence post was being bored out at a lake. Wait, a fence post was being bored out or a fence post hole? Anyway, it was being bored out at Lake... Wow. Winnipesaukee? I'll just say that. Winnipesaukee in New Hampshire. On the land of an influential local man named Seneca Ladd. What baffled workers... They're baffled. What baffled workers pulled out of the ground that day was a brown egg-shaped rock measuring about 4 inches long and 2.5 inches thick. Oh, yeah, I've seen this before. It was encased in clay and covered with carvings of abstract shapes like inverted arrows, a moon, and some spirals and dots, as well as various objects such as an ear of corn and a human face, the meanings of which are a complete mystery, as is who made it and why. But to me, I've seen it before. It looks like the Ica stones, which we've talked about before. All the tens of thousands of them were found down in Mexico and or in Peru, sorry, that have like men using telescopes to look at the stars and people riding dinosaurs and shit.
Yeah, that's incredibly the ones ancient. That the guy apparently admitted that he made up.
After being like taken in by the police and tortured.
Yeah.
Yeah, I totally made those. Sorry. Yeah, because he would have been charged with lots of he would have been sent to jail for a long time for selling ancient artifacts to people.
Yeah.
Yeah. Through the entire eggstone is a single hole bored all the way through it from top to bottom and created by two different sized bits for reasons just as inscrutable as anything else about the artifact.
Wow.
Ladd himself took full credit for the discovery, even though he had had no hand in actually finding it. He put it on display and thought it to be some relic of a mysterious native tribe. The strange rock was in his possession until his death, after which it was donated to the New Hampshire Historical Society in 1927 and finally properly studied, although such analysis has found no clear answers. It remains unknown what the strange relic's origin, purpose, or even its age is, although some have speculated that the hole made through it may have been made with power tools in the 20th century, of course. Other than that, no one really has a clue as to what the Lake Winnipesaukee mysterious stone is, and the answer may be forever buried in history. Look at this thing.
Man.
Yeah.
Yeah, that looks Egyptian.
Yeah.
What kind of stone was it? What kind of...
It doesn't say.
It looks like...
It's a great question.
Black granite.
I remember reading that it was something very hard. Yeah. But see how it's a... it's kind of a embedded relief. Like they dug out, but they left the corn. You know?
It looks... Yeah.
That's... They're moon people. It's the moon eye people.
Kind of... It's like... Similar to a cylinder seal as well.
Yeah. What mysteries do these rocks hold within them that we have yet uncovered? What forces led to their creation? Where do their origins lie? We have yet to understand them, and they have served to remain mysterious ciphers amongst the landscape of the weird in New England. Being the rocks that they are, they will no doubt be around for some time, forever taunting us and baffling us until long after we are gone, remaining there as inscrutable as always, perhaps until the end of time, which is what we are at. The end of time for this show. But
that's really cool. I've never seen that one, the egghead.
Yeah, the egg stone. So those articles that I read were from mysteriousuniverse.org. It's a great site. It has lots of fantastic articles, as well as being the website of a podcast that I started listening to a long time ago. So they cover a lot of subjects over the many years that they've been doing podcasts about mysterious stuff in the universe.
Yeah, those are great articles, man.
Yep. So what do you think about those? That the Dighton Rock looks a lot like Jodicola to me.
Yeah, that's what I thought it was at first, but I need to take a look at those more.
I should sometimes just sit down and like look up mysterious etchings and carvings and rocks in the Americas, because like actual North America, because there's a lot of them.
Yeah. It's just more evidence that there's a lot going on here that no one understands and that the standard model does not explain.
Right. But I think we could safely say that last one is an egghead.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. The egghead rock. I am the Eggman.
All right. Thank you guys very much. That was episode 57 of Brothers of the Serpent podcast. Hope you enjoyed it. We didn't get lost and die. We destroyed a cloud with our brains. That was awesome. We really did. Like, we did some tie through the gauntlet down or the snakeskin. He was like, hey, bro, so you talked about that cloud busting. So you think you can break that cloud right there? And I'm looking at it. And all the other guys are out there. It's early in the morning. We're all having a cigarette or whatever. And they're like, what is this? What is this cloud busting stuff? And I'm like, well, okay. So see that cloud out there? It was this big. If you held your thumb out, it wouldn't cover it completely, but it would come close. So it was a little fluffy cloud out there. And I was like, if you focus on the sky, look at that cloud, focus on the sky, and imagine the sky without the cloud there. And previous to that, the cloud had just been sitting there for a long time. And so we all started staring at it, and it just started to vanish almost instantly. And everyone was like, oh, my God, it's gone. I'm like, dude, we are totally destroying this cloud right now. They're like, holy crap, this is really working. We kept looking at it. Just freaking within 2 minutes, it was completely gone. There were other clouds around it, and they did not go away.
And I missed it. I was inside doing something. I came out, and Wesley was like, dude, we totally just destroyed, busted that cloud, bro.
It was completely, blew my freaking mind, man. That cloud was gone. Dude, we just totally destroyed it.
That's classic.
So that was awesome. Yeah.
You never know what the power of the snake force can be.
That's right. Power of a snake force. Destroy clouds with your mind. So I want to thank Kyle for all the production. It's badass and it keeps getting better. Kyle and Ty for all the music. Laura for all the intros. They are fantastic.
Except for this one. Thank you, Russ, for this intro.
That's right. Thanks to me for this intro. And you. And thanks to Brenner for the sands of time and the monitor. The watcher monitor.
Yeah. Even though we didn't use it at all this
That's
time.
That's right, because the watcher couldn't be here.
Out here saving lives.
In space, saving lives. Alien ones. He runs a space ambulance.
Right, thanks everybody.
That's right. Thanks to all of you listeners. You guys, we couldn't do this without you guys. You guys are awesome. All the feedback we've been getting recently has been great. So thank you guys very much.
This show is history. Ha ha ha!